안녕하세요, 여러분. 김지윤입니다. 저는 오늘 부산에 와 있는데요. 정말 특별한 분을 만나기 위해서 부산에 왔습니다. 제37대 주한미 해군 사령관 마이클 도넬리 제독과 함께합니다. Good afternoon, Admiral Donnelly.
Good afternoon.
Well, thank you so much for being with us today.
Oh, it's absolutely my pleasure.
How are you, by
Very good,
the way?
very good. Thank you.
Well, me and my friends sometimes jokingly talk about, so if there's a war between the United States and the rest of the world, then which side are you going to bet on?
Yeah, well, absolutely. There's no other military as capable as the United States military, and it's the combination of our joint forces and our ability to affect all domains in warfare. And it's also our ability to be present and out and about throughout the world, alongside our friends and allies. But to give you some background, the real strength of the United States military and the United States Navy is in our personnel. So the United States economy is one of the strongest in the world, and it comes from the innovation and the energy of our people. And the United States Navy is made up of over 400,000 active and reserve sailors, and they are a direct reflection, all volunteer, of the diversity of the American population. And they bring with them into the military service all the diversity of perspective and experience and innovation that keeps us at the leading edge as a military and as a Navy. So I'm completely confident in the capability of the United States, and I'm certain that we are capable against any would-be adversary.
So you're going to bet on the United States.
I absolutely would. I absolutely would. And all those sailors, Marines, airmen, and soldiers that actually keep us from getting into that situation of conflict.
I see. I heard the naval power is getting more important in modern warfare. So why is that so?
Naval power is important for many of the obvious points that 70% of the Earth is covered by water, and a large amount of the world's trade, the majority of world's trade, goes over the oceans. The sea space is important that we have influence to ensure that the freedom of the seas, that its existence as a global commons, and that the international order and freedom for all countries to operate on that exists. So with that comes the responsibility of the United States Navy and naval power. And naval power is very relevant because in that unique environment, we have the ability to scale its use from just presence to posturing for combat operations if necessary. And that provides us the ability to allow space for diplomacy and, at worst case, response in crisis or conflict.
I see. Well, I was told recently you were promoted and also going to be transferred pretty soon to Yokosuka, and you're going to be the commander of Carrier Strike Group 5. Congratulations, sir.
Thank you very much. 감사합니다.
Carrier Strike Group 5, it's the Ronald Reagan belongs to and also is part of the US 7th Fleet.
That's correct.
So for those who are not really familiar with the 7th Fleet and also the system, could you please tell us about it, like, the history and the coverage of the 7th Fleet and also the Carrier Strike Group 5 and how is it composed of, etc.
Sure. U.S. 7th Fleet is the largest U.S. Navy fleet, the largest of its seven fleets, and it covers over 124 million square kilometers, and it ranges from the international dateline out to the India-Pakistan border, and all the way from the Kuril Islands in the north down to Antarctica. At any time, there's over 150 aircraft assigned to the region, as well as over 70 ships and submarines, and at any time, we also have more than 20,000 sailors and Marines deployed and operating in the region. So it's an extremely large and important region, and it's a region where we constantly have forces deployed to show our presence and ability to respond in crisis or conflict.
Wow, as a commander of a Carrier Strike Group 5, you probably have a huge responsibility and also duties as well.
I think it certainly is not lost as America's only forward-deployed strike group of how important the role is in representing the nation, of being the forward-deployed, ready-to-respond force. We are the most visible force to our partners and allies in the region, and being able to provide that assurance and credible capability that America is resolved to support them and lawful order and openness of the global commons is an important mission, and I think all the sailors of the strike group take that seriously.
So recently, the United States is paying close attention to the Indo-Pacific area. So I was wondering how seriously the U.S. government and U.S. Navy is perceiving the threat from the rise of China.
Well, the United States certainly recognizes the Indo-Pacific region as the most consequential in terms of national strategy, and recognizes the great power competition that is caused by a resurgent China. And that's because of the importance of this area to global economies. And it includes over $5 trillion in global trade. And the importance of this to so many nations that border the South China Sea and throughout the region for access to resources, including live resources like fisheries, that any coercion by any of the states that are self-interested or seeking national priorities over international law or the good order of the global commons is going to be challenged by the United States to support our friends and allies and support their interests regardless of the size of the country, large or small. They have the right to the basic elements of global trade, of their own governments, of human rights, and the United States is going to support that.
So from a strategic point of view, how important is South China Sea?
The South China Sea is extremely important. A very large amount of the world's trade goes through there. And as I said, over $5 trillion worth of international trade goes through there. And Korea knows that as well as anybody, with Busan being an essential hub at the northeast edge of the South China Sea. So the access through there, through the international waters, through the recognized international boundaries, allows global trade and the economy and the well-being of all the nations, not just in the region, but worldwide. And those interests will be supported by the United States and our commitments to the region and our support to our friends and allies.
Well, we often hear the U.S. Navy conducted FONUP, the Freedom of Navigation Operation. Well, some people may think, well, I mean, just crossing the sea lane, what's the thing, what's the deal? But you can probably explain us why it's important and what effects do you expect?
Yeah, freedom of navigation operations are fundamental to international maritime law, and they reinforce and establish the normalcy that states have the right to access of international sea space, and that nations are obliged to comply with international law and international agreements regarding those sea space. So the United States demonstrates that regularly with all countries, that we will sail, steam, and fly wherever international law allows. And with that, that reinforces the requirement for all nations to comply with those international agreements and international law.
Is it really effective? I was just always wondering what kind of impact. I mean, would they have any changes as a consequence after the FONUP?
Well, for one thing, it establishes the precedence and the normalcy that it's not an exceptional act. It is nearly steaming, sailing, or flying where international law allows. And it's a demonstration that we're not going to acquiesce to coercion or to bullying of any nation that is going to choose to extend themselves for their own national rights beyond those international agreements. So in that regard, it is a credible, visible dedication to making sure that we can maintain the international good order.
So it's just like, you know, you are doing, you know, what is given, like the rights that is given to you and other countries as well.
Yeah, I think that's an excellent way to put it. It's not an exceptional operation. It's something that is conducted wherever there is a challenge or question about anybody's desire to extend themselves beyond those international agreements. And it is just doing what's normally allowed.
Because it's open sea.
Right.
Okay. Well, I heard recently the USS Ronald Reagan and HMS Queen Elizabeth did a joint drill. And correct me if I'm wrong, I heard it's the first time in history. Is that right?
Well, actually, the Queen Elizabeth is in this region, and she's conducted joint drills with USS America, as well as looking to conduct drills potentially with our other U.S. aircraft carrier, USS Carl Vinson, in the region. And it would be the first time, because it is the Queen Elizabeth's first maiden deployment, and she happens to be in this area of operations. But operating with our allies is really a routine event. We do it frequently. We do it all over the world. It's very fortunate and a demonstration of the UK's commitment to the importance of this area of the world that she happens to be here to allow the US 7th Fleet ships to interact with her. Other events that we participate with members of European nations as well as nations from South America and even Africa include the Rim of the Pacific exercises that we do in the vicinity of Hawaii and the Philippine Sea. And it's quite common to have 11 or more nations come together for those large naval exercises. So it's a great opportunity on Queen Elizabeth's maiden voyage and her maiden patrol to come out and operate together. And she, in fact, in that strike group is a real demonstration of international resolve as she is patrolling with ships from the Netherlands and from America and aircraft from the United States Marine Corps.
In the Pacific region, which area do you think is most likely to have the escalation of tension between the U.S. and allied power and China?
Well, we look with our overall presence here in the Indo-Pacific throughout the entire region to present a credible deterrence to any conflict. And with the commitment of our like-minded partners and allies around the region to present to any would-be adversary or foe that tonight is not the night to start a fight. But there are areas, specifically in the South China Sea, where nations are putting forth claims and coercion that are not in line with the international order. And those pose a challenge to the stability of the region. And that's why it's incredibly important to the United States to maintain a presence, to maintain support to our allies and friends. And we'll continue to do that and sail, fly, or steam wherever international law allows us to support those objectives.
Well, a lot of Koreans would like to know where the line is between ROK and U.S. stands, particularly after U.S. exit out of Afghanistan.
Yeah, well, I can tell you, having had the opportunity to be here and work with U.S. Forces Korea in my role as commander of U.S. Naval Forces Korea, and to operate here in Korea for 2.5 years, that the ROK-U.S. alliance is ironclad, and our relationship between the United States Navy and the ROK Navy is watertight. We share common values and common purpose. We are incredibly interoperable as a fighting force and aligned in our purpose and committed to the common purposes of peace and stability on the peninsula. I think our nations recognize the vital importance of Korean Peninsula to the region of Northeast Indo-Pacific.
Well, whenever I meet the U.S. military personnel, then I can see that they are so proud and they have high pride in their country and the military and themselves. I believe you are too. So I would like to hear why you decided to serve your country.
Yeah, it wasn't any one direct person that pulled me in or family member into the naval service. And as I pointed out, all of our service members in the United States are volunteers, but I had a keen interest in flying as a naval aviator and picked up that interest when I was in high school and just pursued it. So in going to the university, I went into a program which is similar to what they have here in Korea in the Reserve Officer Training Program and received my commission and have just had incredibly fortunate opportunities where I was able to reach my dream of flying off aircraft carriers, and then my career has continued to have tremendous open doors as I've gone on. And I found myself in outstanding places from Europe to here in Asia and today here in Korea. So I'm incredibly thankful for the opportunity and it's been really fantastic.
Because I remember I read in the article, I also looked up the Wikipedia. Yeah, because the jet you flew with was...
Yeah, when I started flying back in the early 1990s, I was flying the F-14 Tomcat. And then I continued that until the late 1990s when the Tomcat began to be phased out, and then I transitioned to the F-18 Super Hornet. And I continued flying the Super Hornet until the early 2000s, at which point I transitioned and was selected to be trained as a nuclear qualified aviator, and started captaining ships and eventually an aircraft carrier, the USS Ronald Reagan. And all of that has brought me here to Korea and this fortunate opportunity of working for U.S. Naval Forces Korea the last 2.5 years.
Well, I feel dizzy all of a sudden.
I will tell you that I'm very blessed to have had the career that I've had, and I consider it very special that I've had a unique opportunity to not only have flown in naval aviation and flown fighter and strike aircraft off the decks of aircraft carriers all over the world, but then I've also had this second life in the Navy where I've been trained as a nuclear operator and given the opportunity to command ships, and it's really the best of all worlds.
So when was the most proud moment of yours in the service?
Well,
there should be plenty, but
yeah, I tell you, as I look back over my career, I get asked frequently what was my favorite job or the most exciting part. And at each stage, there's always been something extremely exciting about it. And when I think I've topped out, something even better comes up and comes about. And here in Korea, I've just really enjoyed the opportunity, though I'm not flying and I'm not commanding a ship, to be working so close with our Korean allies and the ROK Navy. And one of the things I'm most proud of is through all of the challenges during my tour of the last 2.5 years, and there's constantly our national interests and political prerogatives that overlie the alliance. But down at the military and the Navy to Navy level, and I'm very proud of the progress we've been able to keep on pace over the last 2.5 years.
You did the first speech at the NC Dinos game on the 1st of July.
I did.
Yeah.
That was a special opportunity. I'm kind of proud about that also.
Oh, yeah.
That was a very unique opportunity for me to get to participate with the first pitch at the NC Dinos game. And I am a real fan of Korean baseball. And I didn't come to Asia being a baseball fan, but once I got here, I really became captivated. So I have a friend of mine who was an American who pitched for a Korean team, Joe Wieland, and had the opportunity to see him play around the peninsula before COVID. And then this opportunity came up that was made available by our partners over at ROK Fleet here in Busan. And they set up the chance for me to go over there, meet some Americans on the team, and throw out the first pitch. So it was incredibly special for me. It made me feel almost Korean, so I was pretty excited. And has really been a great pinnacle point for our 2.5 years that we've had here in Korea. So it really was fantastic.
How was the pitch? I have to ask him, not you. How was it? It was a good pitch. I couldn't.
Okay. Could have been better. It wasn't. Didn't strike anybody out. That's for sure.
That's great.
You're going easy on
me. Well, you've been here in Korea more than 2 years. I believe as a commander of U.S. Naval Forces Korea. So how was your experience in Korea?
It's really been fantastic. As I said, just professionally, it's been a high point to be able to involve myself so closely with our ROK Navy allies. And I've operated around the Pacific for a large part of my 32 years in the United States Navy, and specifically very much so over the last 10 years where I've lived here in 7th Fleet. But it wasn't until I got here to Korea as the commander of U.S. Naval Forces Korea that I really realized the depth of the relationship we have with our ROK partners. And I've got very close friendships and professional relationships with my ROK Navy counterparts after my tour here. I've got a great appreciation for the professionalism of their force, their sailors, and definitely their leadership. It's an incredibly capable Navy, ready to confront any challenge that comes its way. And I'm very proud to have them as an ally and as a partner. Just very excited about the tour we've had here. And living in Korea has been fantastic for me and my family. We've enjoyed everything from the baseball to the food, and it's just been tremendous. And I'm overall, I have nothing to regret about this tour. I'm very excited about it, and I will look back on it with tremendously fond memories.
Yeah, well, you were probably the highest ranking officer that I've ever met. So I always wanted to ask this question. So what's the most important thing to have good Navy?
The people. The most important thing for a good Navy is the people. It's about the culture and about getting the responsibility down to the lowest level of those sailors that are involved in the force, because they bring the innovation, they bring the ideas, and they bring the energy. And the equipment is obviously important. It supports the capability and it provides you the means to make the decisions and everything. But without good people that are purposeful and understand their mission, even the best equipped Navy will not be successful. And that's why I'm so completely convinced and believe that the U.S. Navy is the most formidable fighting force in the world, and we're capable against any adversary, and it's because of our people.
Yeah, because I'm always amazed to see how those, you know, Navy and Marines and Army so loyal to the country, and the strong patriotism that is very unique. I mean, all those armies and militaries in the world are probably the same, but
yeah, I think that's true. And like you said, you can go other places and find high levels of pride. But what our force, I think, also brings is a very, very high level of professionalism. And we make a very serious investment in the training of our people. They have a very high level of competence, and they're what carry us. So I'm very proud of them and very happy to be part of the service with them.
And American public always show the respect, tremendous respect.
Yeah, I'm very thankful to the appreciation that all of our service members get. And as I said, they're all volunteers. It's a very, very small percentage of the U.S. total population that actually ever serves in the military. So those back home tend to have very great appreciation for the sacrifice of the service members and also their families who are traveling with them or spending long periods of time away while their service member is out doing their job and conducting operations.
Well, I think it's about time to wrap up, but you know, I would like you to give a last word to the Korean public.
The last thing I'll say is thank you very much for the opportunity for my family and I to have lived here, learned so much about the culture. I'm very excited and confident, as I said, in the strength of our ironclad alliance. And it gives me great confidence as I go forward into my next job. And I look forward to returning both professionally and hopefully with my family for vacation. And kachi kapsida.
Thank you so much, sir. I really appreciate it. And we are leaving in the end of September.
I am. At the end of September, we'll wrap up our tour and move on to the next adventure at Carrier Strike Group 5.
I see. Bon voyage.
감사합니다.
Thank you so much. 감사합니다.